Creating high-quality real estate photos using the Flambian technique is often done incorrectly from some simple misunderstandings of how the Flambian process works. I'm going to set the record straight in this episode by covering the what's, whys, and hows of doing the Flambian technique, and also some issues that may come up along the way that you can address very quickly, and that way you can apply the proper techniques to Flambian to get those high-quality real estate photos. For those who don't know me, my name is Nathan Kuhl. I'm a professional real estate photographer in Southern California, and I've written best-selling books specifically on real estate photography as well. I use the Flambian technique for all of my interior work. I've done so for years, and I've shot literally thousands of homes here in the local area using that Flambian technique. But I've seen a disturbing trend lately where other vloggers, YouTubers, and also public groups on social media are providing inaccurate information on Flambian that can work some of the time, but it won't work all the time. And most of the time, it'll lead to results that are a lower quality than what true Flambian can provide you. Flambian is used for higher end work, but I use it throughout all of my work because you can streamline it through your workflow. So by covering these fundamentals in this video, if you're just starting out as a real estate photographer or haven't tried Flambian yet, this will set the stage with a good foundation. And if you are an experienced Flambian photographer, I've made this so that it's also a recap of those fundamentals as well. The first fundamental of Flambian is to create high quality, natural feeling, color correct images by taking two primary shots, one that's purely ambient and another shot using flash. Those two shots are then blended in a unique way that avoids problems that are common with HDR, such as color cast from various lighting sources throughout a scene, unnatural shadows, and a whole lot of other artifacts that can come up out of doing the lower grade HDR. You can also shoot an optional window pull, which will get you a clearer view to the outside, but this isn't always required. And it's separate from the Flambian process. I do show how to do window pulls in another video. I have a link to that free tutorial in the description for this video, but of course it is separate from the Flambian process. Of course, window pulls and Flambian are covered in my book on interior real estate photography and lighting guide as well, so I have links to all that in the description also. But when it comes to Flambian, the purpose of the ambient and flashed shots is where the confusion and misinformation comes from, so let's discuss that real quick. The ambient shot, which is the first shot taken in the Flambian workflow, is used for adding light and shadows only. Color is not used from the ambient shot, only its luminance, since the ambient shot will be used in luminosity blending mode in Photoshop or similar software like GIMP. This is why it's important not to use normal blending mode on the ambient shot, since the colors in ambient photos are not as accurate as flash shots, which I'll get to next. But remember, that's one of the problems with HDR, is because you're using color out of ambient shots, you'll never get everything as correct by relying on ambient alone. We only want the ambient's luminance, its light and shadows. When it comes to the ambient shot, though not all of its luminance is used, allowing you to balance flash and ambient lighting as you see fit. A lot of the time, the ambient shot's layer opacity is just set to 50%. As you can see here, notice how its blending mode is also set to luminosity. Another option, you can also selectively add luminance by using a layer mask and a brush on that ambient layer, like in this case, where you can paint and erase from the layer mask to be more specific to where you want the luminance to be. Either technique is fine. The idea is not to have 100% ambient luminance, but control where the luminance will be and to what extent. The flash shot, though, is different. Its purpose is to obtain accurate color by dominating the scene with a single light source, your flash. The flash shot will look flashy, but it won't once luminance is added from the ambient shot. To dominate the scene with flash lighting, your camera's exposure for the flash shot is set so that most of the ambient light is eliminated, thus allowing flash light to dominate the scene with its color temperature and not much else. White balance is then easier to control, and it's often obtained by using a specific auto white balance setting in your camera, which will vary though by camera brand, so I have a link to another free tutorial on that in the description as well that'll cover, based on your camera brand, what you probably should be using for auto white balance. By the way, for advanced photographers that have done a lot of flambient work, manual Kelvin settings are certainly an option, but if you're just starting out, then auto white balance is recommended. Remember also that white balance doesn't matter for the ambient shot since its colors will not be used. White balance only applies to the flash shots and optional window pulls. And of course, as mentioned earlier, window pulls are optional, and there's a link to that free tutorial in the description for this video. Moving on though to the next fundamental. The second fundamental for flambient photography is exposure. The goal for exposing both ambient and flash shots is to expose to the right, also called ETTR, so that the predominant peak on the histogram is around the 3/4 mark on the tonal range. That isn't always the case. It's going to depend on room colors, but it is applicable for the majority of interior photography work. The trickier part though is to use a balance of ISO to aperture along with proper flash power so that you can achieve correct exposure and depth of field while also controlling the color. ISO is the first exposure setting to consider, setting it to around 320 or 400 in most cases so that you don't introduce color casts from over flashing. Remember that lower ISOs require more flash power and higher ISOs require less flash power. So we don't want to use ISO 100 and risk using so much flash power that we cast color all over the room and have more problems. But we need to keep our ISO within a measurable range for quality. Besides, most cameras today have little to no noise below ISO 500 if the image is exposed properly, so don't fear high ISOs. Many new flambient photographers try to use ISO 100 to get the best quality, but that's something from the old days. That's not needed today. It'll just cause problems obtaining proper flash power while over-flashing a scene, causing color casts. A lower ISO, like 200, can be used for extremely bright rooms, but in those cases, when the room is so bright from copious sun streaming in, you're basically shooting an exterior shot, flash may not be necessary, or very little flash could be used just for fill. This is the exception, not the rule, when it comes to flambient. In most cases, ISO 320 or 400 will work well. Aperture is the next exposure setting. There is no need to exceed f/8 since most everything will be in focus using a wide-angle lens for interior photography. In fact, f/7.1 or f/6.3 will work just as well in many cases for large rooms, which will get you plenty enough depth of field while not stressing your flash power. Remember that the smaller the aperture, the higher the F number, the more flash power you'll need, something I discuss in my book on interior photography and also the lighting guide. So don't try to use a small aperture like F11, as that, like low ISOs, will require far too much flash power. F8 will give you plenty enough depth of field for most interior work and also save you on then the amount of flash that you have to work with. While ISO and aperture stay the same for the ambient and flash shots, the next exposure setting, shutter speed, will be different for those two shots. To set the shutter speed for the ambient shot after setting ISO and aperture, you adjust the shutter speed so that the camera's histogram exposes to the right and you take that ambient shot. That's it. The ambient shot's done. If you have a mirrorless camera and you have configured your flash trigger for center pin isolation like I show in other videos, then you can see the histogram in real time on the back screen of your camera with the histogram changing as you adjust the shutter speed. This can really speed along your flambient workflow. The flash shot is a bit more involved as it requires a two-step process. First, adjust the shutter speed so that most ambient light goes completely away. Not completely, but very close to it. This often works around 1/100th of a second if you're using that ISO 320 f/8 type of setting. And if you're using a mirrorless camera, then you can watch this in real time as well and watch that ambient light start falling off. Then fire a flash shot. Using enough flash power though so that the shot exposes to the right. This often requires a couple of shots to see how well flash is spreading in the space you are shooting, and if the histogram is too low, then increase flash power, take another shot. If it's too high, back off the flash power, take another shot. And if you're off by a stop or less or so, don't sweat it. That can easily be adjusted in post without any loss of quality on most cameras today shooting in RAW. Just make sure that your flash and ambient shots before doing the flambient blending are exposing to the right. Exposing window poles is a different animal. It has nothing to do with these, by the way. It has nothing to do with exposing on the histogram. Instead, window poles expose for the outside view while overexposing the interior with flash. That's a whole different topic. So once again, I've got that free tutorial down in the description for the video if you want to start covering some of those aspects of doing window poles. Back to flambient. The third fundamental of flambient is achieving a primary color temperature. As mentioned earlier, the main goal of the flashed shot is to dominate the scene with a single light source to then obtain a single color temperature. While you can eliminate nearly all ambient light with the proper flash shot exposure, using only one flash and one flash shot may not be enough to dominate the scene and accomplish this. For large areas, it's best to do flash composites like I show in my lighting guide. This requires taking multiple flash shots and quite often with multiple flash setups to distribute the flash lighting, thus ensuring accurate color throughout a space. By dominating the scene with flash light, you will solve a color problem that many photographers aren't aware of, and that's that color is made up of not only hue, like red, green, and blue, and saturation, the intensity of those hues, but also luminance, or brightness, which is often referred to as the HSL or HSB model, which has a profound effect on color. The HSB model is something I delve into in my book, Mastering Color in Photography, since it's a crucial element of photography in general, but it is so often overlooked. When it comes to flambient photography, the luminance factor of the flash shots, basically the L in an HSL model or B in an HSB model, is what provides an even color throughout a space. If you don't have enough flash light throughout a scene, then dark areas lacking luminance in those areas will not have the same color as the rest of the space when luminance from the ambient shot is then applied to them. So to get a more accurate flambient image, it's best, if you can, to have flash lighting throughout the space, at least to some degree, so that you do see color, ensuring then that you are still exposing to the right. The fourth fundamental also relates to luminance, which sometimes shows up as discoloration in shadowed areas. This is caused by dark, harsh shadows in the flashed shot, where those shadows are so dark that they push past the shadows region of the tonal range and enter the blacks area of the tonal range, lacking almost all of their luminance. When you then apply ambient luminance over those areas, an inaccurate color is revealed, which is often orange, but this is easy to fix. First, most of the time, if you're seeing very harsh shadows in your images from ceiling fans or whatnot, you're probably using improper flash techniques, such as pointing the flash a little bit forward or having the flash too close to a ceiling or wall, thus causing harsher, less diffuse light to be directed into the room. The harsher the light, the harsher the shadows, and thus lower luminance in those shadows. Softer light has softer shadows, it will have better luminance and then better color. So by proper use of your flash techniques, you can soften the shadows so much that they will still contain accurate color. Sometimes though, this can't be avoided, or going quickly through a property, you just make a mistake and it happens. So it can be fixed. If you follow the steps in my lighting guide but still have these shadow artifacts, easy repairs you can do, like using a color layer, it's what I did in this example, or a color match layer, or other techniques that I show in another free tutorial, and I've got a link to that also in the description of this video. But don't let this issue lead you into taking shortcuts like using normal mode instead of luminosity blending mode when you're doing your flambient blending. Just work on your flash technique, get this right so that you don't have those harsh shadows, and when you do, watch some of my videos on ways to repair them if they happen. Similarly, discoloration can also occur from glare caused by flash reflections, mostly a lot of times it shows up on shiny wood, sometimes leather, other shiny reflective surfaces. These reflections exceed the opposite end of the tonal range, pushing past highlights into whites, losing accurate color from the overabundance of luminance. These artifacts will often show up as gray or a washed out look. It's the same issue regarding the HSL-HSB model that the shadow problem has. It's just at the other end of the spectrum. It's a super easy fix using a color layer, which I show in another of my free tutorials specifically on just fixing kitchen cabinets like this. I have a link to that free tutorial also in the description for this video. Since the flambient technique is different from other techniques that are used in other genres of photography, it's understandable that when a lot of photographers face the issues that they do using flambient by not following all of the various fundamentals that go along with it, that they might revert to other types of repair, fixes, and shortcuts that they might be used to from other genres of photography. And while they can work some of the time, they won't work all the time, and you will end up having lower quality flambient type images. To get the highest quality, you do need to apply the fundamentals that I talked about here, and then also practice. And this is a key to it, is that you need to practice this at home before taking it into the field. Any skill that you want to be able to perfect, any craft that you want to hone, does take practice. If you can get a skill down in an afternoon, then anybody can. And of course, you'll get results that show that. That's amateur type stuff, and that's where HDR falls in. But if you want to really progress, if you really want to move through your career, then you need to show that you can produce images and edit images and photograph images that show that you're a pro so that you can get paid like one. Leave the run and gun HDR to the photographers that are in a constant race to the bottom in pricing and start competing on quality. Work on your skills, hone your skills, work on that flambient technique. You'll start moving forward in your career to open up other opportunities to push you forward as a professional real estate photographer.